Welcome back, orienteering fans. Over the last few episodes, we have learned how to read topographic maps, but they are most useful when used with a compass. This episode will focus on using a basic compass, which you could buy from your camping supplier or online for under $10, though to do the higher level field work later in the course, you will want a compass with one of these dip indicators. These are generally a little better compasses that should run between, you know, $50 to $100, and the lower $50 end ones, they're just fine for beginners. You don't have to spend a lot of money to start. The compass of choice for the professional geologist, though, is the Brunton compass, and those usually start at $200. And you can do everything you really need to with the $50 version. So let's use one of these types of compasses here, and we'll look at the Brunton later on. To start, the red end of the needle is the north-seeking end, and the white, black, or blue is the south-seeking. We see the azimuth markings around the outside of the black dial, starting at 0 degrees for north, 90 degrees for east, 180 degrees for south, and 270 for west. Our mirror can be used to read the compass when taking a line of sight through the sighting hole in the lid, or if you have to read the compass at an odd angle. The large red arrow of the orienteering dial is what I will call the orienting arrow. It is the marker over which you want to place your red north-seeking needle. We can use this concept of putting the magnetic north needle over the orienting arrow in two different ways. First, let's say we're at a location and we want to know the direction to some landform. This is commonly used for triangulation of distances and locations. I pick one of these tick mark ends of my compass as the pointer end, it doesn't matter which to start with, then line up the compass to point directly at the object of interest. This is when using the sight and mirror can be especially helpful. Once lined up, we turn the orienting dial so the orienting arrow is directly beneath the magnetic north needle. Now we look at the tick mark that was facing the object of interest and read off the azimuth in degrees. This is the bearing to the object of interest from your present location. We triangulate when we need to find our present location, which may be too indistinct to find easily on a map. By finding three landmarks, we can both sight to and locate on our map, and taking the 180-degree bearing from our sightings, we can draw lines from these three known landmarks to literally triangulate to find our location on the map. The other way to use the magnetic needle over the orienting arrow is that you've been told the bearing you need to go to. You pretty much do everything we just did in reverse. Turn the orienting dial until the bearing is lined up with the marker facing your forward direction. Now turn the compass until the north-seeking needle is over the orienting arrow, and your compass now points in the direction of interest. Another use of lining up the magnetic north arrow with the orienteering arrow is to properly orientate your map in space. By taking our compass dial and aligning it with the tick mark towards the mirror, making it our north direction, we can line up our compass with the grid lines within our topographic map, and then turn the map and the compass until the magnetic needle is over the large red orienting arrow, and now our map north is lined up with the real world north. But maybe you've been asked to go a certain distance at this bearing. What if you don't have a laser ranger or even a tape measure? Perhaps you have legs. And if you don't, I bet you can think of a way to do what I'm about to describe. I know disabled does not mean helpless. We will need a tape measure to start with, because you will need to measure out a distance that will have to be walked over several steps and is easy to work with mathematically. Because I'm working with the USGS maps, it is most useful to train my students to know their pace in feet. So I have measured out a length of sidewalk that is exactly 100 feet long. To calculate our pace, we start with both heels on the 0-foot line, then we take a step. It doesn't really matter if you start with your left or right foot, but don't count that first step down. Take a step, lift the back foot, bring it forward, put it down, and that is one pace. Repeat. So let's use me as an example. This is one pace, 2, 3, 4, 16 and a half. Okay, I took 16 and a half paces to go 100 feet. By the way, we use the pace instead of just a step to even out any differences in gait between your legs. For me, I come out close enough to round to 6 feet even and make my life easy. On rougher terrain, I do usually pace a slightly smaller distance, so this is reasonable. Now, I have been asked to go 60 feet at a certain bearing. I just line up the bearing with my tick mark, turn the compass so the north-seeking arrow is over the orienting arrow, and I go in the direction of the tick mark for 10 paces, because 6 feet per pace times 10 paces equals 60 feet. And look what I found.
Is that your normal walk?